Would you marry a 6-7 year old child?
Yes, yes, of course.
That's a pedophile.
Yes, yes. If my daughter reached age of menstruation at 9 years old, I would say you are ready to get married.
He said he'd marry a 6 year old. He said he'd marry a 6 year old, live on camera.
Don't run away.
Pedophilia right here.
Don't run away.
Brother,
don't run away.
He marry a 6 year old.
Don't run away.
Would you marry a six-year-old?
Yes, I can marry.
Yes.
Hear that? Would you marry? What the heck?
Can you marry your mother?
Oh my goodness.
We do not marry.
Can you sleep your mother?
Our mothers.
Can you sleep your mother?
We do not marry our mothers.
I will show you.
You said you'll marry a 6 year old, is that right? Would you marry a 6 year old? Would you marry a 6 year old?
What's your boy?
You said you'll marry a 6 year old, right?
I said yes. How many times?
What?
What's your boy?
What the?
What is your boy?
Oh my days. Brother! This is a pedophile.
You're a 6 year old girl.
This
is a pedophile.
Brother.
A child.
Brother.
This is
pedophilia. This is pedophilia.
No. I will not. Because you're a pedophile.
No. The Bible. No, brother.
I'm almost 54 years old.
Yeah, I'm so shocked. I am so shocked. I am so shocked.
Yes.
I am so shocked for that man.
It's so disgusting. I just can't.
He literally said it so many times. He literally said it so many times. He'll marry a 6 year old. This is a pedophile right here. Say again, would you marry?
My business line. Yes!
What?
Yes!
Police! Police!
Are you house?
Police!
She was 6 when she got married.
It does matter.
Do you agree with child marriages?
Yeah, but you're.
Do you agree with child marriages?
You are.
Do you agree with child marriages?
You're being too emotional. You're
I'm asking you.
You're taking back
I'm asking you a question. Do you agree with child marriages?
Yes, yes.
Do you agree with child marriages?
I'm not going to deny it.
Do you agree with child marriages?
Yes!
Right. That is the problem. The Muhammad's example has led you to the conclusion. Muhammad's example has led you to the conclusion that child marriages are okay. That's a problem. Is this how you're deciding facts? Listen to the arrogance and the conceitedness in your own heart. Because I'm condemning a paedophile. Do you condemn paedophilia?
No, I don't.
You don't condemn paedophilia. Did you hear that? She does not condemn paedophilia. You said that. No one put those words in your mouth.
What an embarrassment. What an embarrassing prophet. What a disgusting religion.
So I have a crazy topic to discuss. It is muta. So I had never heard that term. I'm a revert or convert to Islam. Until a man that I was interested in and was talking to me brought it up. And he's like, hey, have you ever done a muta or heard of a muta? No. I hadn't. So I looked into it and y'all, it's basically like a temporary marriage, which in and of itself is like an oxymoron, right? Like marriage is supposed to be forever. Whatever. So the more I looked into it, I just felt very uneasy about it and didn't like feel comfortable with that term. Because when I want to marry somebody, I want to be with them forever. Like I don't plan to be with somebody just for a short period of time. Like whatever differences we have in a marriage, I'm going to work through those. I want to work through those as a couple, and not just leave because it's hard. Right. So, and he was like, well, if you don't believe in this, you know, this is what, you know, the prophet said is okay. So do you know better than the prophet? And do you like, I don't want to answer that question because no, but this makes me feel very uneasy. So what do you guys that are born Muslims or have studied more than I have, what are your thoughts and opinions on muta marriages?
So what is the difference between such relationship and prostitution or adultery? There's no much difference in prostitution, or if one is to have a concubine, he would just pay her for sleeping with her once or twice or for a few days, and he will let her go. No commitments whatsoever. In the muta marriage, it is the same, to the extent that there is no even need for a divorce. Once the period elapses, that's it. Both do not have any tie anymore. So where is the sukna? وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. And in order to achieve a sukna, the repose, he made between the couple, between the spouses, compassion and mercy. These are some ayat for people who ponder and reflect. So when somebody hires a woman, yes, I would use the word hire, for an hour, for a couple hours, or if he's traveling to one of those countries which are very famous with prostitution, he would spend a day or two with a woman, then by the end he would pay her for the time he spent. How could we ever call this marriage?
مطلقة
بفخر ثلاث مرات
ثلاث مرات مطلقة
على راس السطح وبالمتعة ما بعرف قد العدد شو بدك أكذب؟
أنت عم تلجأ لزواج المتعة ليه؟
سكس هون خلصت هي
كم عقد متعة عاملة؟
ما بعرف الرقم
أطول زواج متعة قد إيه استمر؟
جمعة
أقصر زواج متعة قد إيه؟
نص ساعة
مكان اللقاء وين؟
بالسيارة
بالسيارة؟
آه
لهاللقاء نص ساعة بالسيارة قديش كان المبلغ اتفقتوا عليه؟
100,000
كيف عرفتي إنه خلصت نص ساعة؟
طلعت بالساعة لنوي هلا تنتين ونص بيخلص الوقت ممنوع يبقى يدقرني خلصت
كيف نص ساعة؟
قضاء حاجة خلصت
تتجوزوا نص ساعة ألارم نص ساعة خلصنا قضاء
باي باي
حاجة.
إيه ليش بدي مرمتني كل العمر؟ وباي باي
وشو؟
غيرك أحسن
شو؟
باي باي اللي بعده ليش مستغرب؟ مش بس أنا كل الدنيا هيك
أي أساليب أغراء ممكن تعمليها إذا عجبك رجل؟
بس بتطلع فيه
وإذا ما مش الحال؟
آخر هم مليانين
What an embarrassment. What an embarrassing prophet. What a disgusting religion.
The jinn are also perving on you. The evil ones. Not, of course, all of them. Some of them are brothers in Islam. Assalamu alaikum if they're in the house. No problem. But then there are those that are devils. You've got the atheist jinn. You've got the Hindu jinn. You've got the Buddhist jinn. Allah knows what other religions they might have amongst themselves. They worship Iblis as well. That's what they do. I'm saying, sisters, they're looking at you. Wallahi, when you go outside and you're not covered, or your clothes are not appropriate, or your face is not covered, and you're beautifying yourself, the jinn are looking at you. And wallahi, I have dealt with so many cases, man. I get so many emails. Sisters, they have the jinn is stopping them from getting married. Every time the sister it gets close, the jinn messes it up. Creates a problem of some sort. Some of them are brothers in Islam. Assalamu alaikum if they're in the house, no problem.
Lying is not allowed except for three things. One of them is hadith al-rajul limra'ati, that when a man speaks to his wife, and in Sahih Muslim it says, and when a wife speaks to her husband.
Well, white lies?
It doesn't have to be white. It can be a black lie. Sorry to say. This idea of white lies, it's a modern day thing that people say. There's in the classical works, there's no differentiation there here in the kutub. Like for example, that's not how people understood it. It can be you can lie to your spouse. In this situation, so the issue of this is that.
So can they lie in the context of, for example, if one says, I sense that you've got a second wife, can he say, no, I don't?
Yes, he can. You can say that.
Yes,
I personally believe this is the hadith on the master. لا يحل الكذب إلا في ثلاث. The Prophet said you can do it.
The ayat ra'ad you're about to see is for adults only. If you're a child, please tune off. It's a medical condition that can affect everyone and it is halal and permissible. Lockdown pills. For the moment when you're not feeling up for it. Available in both male and female. 100% authentic natural intimacy vitality pills endorsed in TV's This Morning Celebrity Dr. Chris Steele issue of the Celebrity Angels magazine by Iagra. Also, if you provide a 5-star review after your purchase on Amazon, you can qualify for a free pack. Terms and conditions apply.
This man is being more slippery. He's being more slippery than the lubricants that he sells in his daughter's sex shop. And that's the reality of the situation.
prisoners were taken in as slaves, and then the women were taken as captives and then allotted to the male soldiers or sold on the open market. If they were allotted to a male soldier, it was taken for granted that the male soldier would then have access to her sexually.
And how does consent play into this at all, or can we understand anything about consent from this end? Like, does a female slave have to consent to that, or is it kind of like because she's owned and so therefore?
In the classical thought, the understanding is that by virtue of the fact that she's owned, she does not have the right to consent, or to withhold herself from her master. The master has the full right over her, and her consent does not play anything in this relationship.
If you look just at the Quran, you will get the indication that you can have sexual intercourse with a five-year-old. No. The reason why it's haram to have sexual intercourse with a five-year-old is not found in the Quran at all. If you just read the Quran, it is halal. It would be halal to have sexual intercourse with a five-year-old. Chapter 65, verse 4. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us who you can divorce and who you cannot divorce. And then he says, وَاللَّئِ لَمْ يَحِدْنَ وَاللَّئِ لَمْ يَحِدْنَ And the ones who had never been pubescent before. And by the way, this is very important, yeah? I want all Muslims to be aware of this. The reason why we don't have sexual intercourse with five-year-olds and six-year-olds and seven-year-olds or whatever is not because of puberty. Wait a minute, what did you say? It's not because of puberty, because that verse in the Quran actually says lam yahid. They never had puberty before. You can't go around that. The Quran doesn't say anywhere in the Quran that the woman has to be pubescent. I dare you to find one verse in the Quran where it says you're not allowed to marry someone based on harm, or you're not allowed to have sexual intercourse based on harm, or you're not allowed to marry someone based on puberty. Get me one verse in the Quran which says the woman has to be pubescent.
No.
You know in the Quran it says, Hurmat alaikum ummahatikum. It says you're not allowed to marry your mum. It says you're not allowed to marry your sister, your auntie. Where does it say you're not allowed to marry a pre-pubescent? I'm looking for one verse that you can say. You pinpoint it and say, this is where it says prepubescent marriage or whatever is not allowed. So if you're Quran alone, you're steered towards paedophilia, and a severe type of paedophilia, a severe type of wife abuse.
This Islamic scholar, Farooq Ahmad, has supposedly been caught trying to pick up 14-year-old girls. Roll the clip.
Ahmed, this is me now, yeah? This man is picking up 14-year-old little girls in Bangor High Street, yeah? And I swear to God, yeah, listen, you're outed, Rich. You're a wrong one. You are an absolute beacon. You picked my kid up again,
You picked up my kid again, yeah? She told us.
I swear to God.
Okay.
You're with kids now.
You're with them then. You're with them then.
I'm sorry.
Please. That's what I'm saying, please.
One time. I'm going now, okay?
One time.
I'm going, madam, okay?
Okay, get in, you can go and leave all the kids alone.
Fucking stay away from them kids.
But did you know that this is technically halal in Islam? Quran 65:4. Those of your women as have passed the age of monthly courses, for them the iddah prescribed period. If you have doubts about their periods is 3 months. And for those who have no courses, i.e. they are still immature, their iddah, prescribed period, is 3 months likewise, except in case of death. The waiting period, iddah, is a period of time that the Muslim must wait to remarry. So in this case, they've clearly outlined that you must wait 3 months to marry after divorcing someone who has yet to have had their periods. Wait, so that's a child in this case. Isn't that crazy, folks? Hadith Sahih Muslim 8:33:10. Chapter, it is permissible for a father to arrange the marriage of a young virgin. Aisha, Allah be pleased with her, reported, Allah's apostle married me when I was 6 years old and I was admitted to his house when I was 9 years old. What they mean by admitting is that Muhammad brutally consummated the marriage when the girl was 9, which is absolutely abhorrent and disgusting, but something Muslims like Farooq Ahmad look up to and accept.
How many times have I ejaculated in my life? At least...
I was like, oh my God, I was gonna answer it like that.
sex in paradise. Now, what's wrong with that? I don't know. You have to tell me. Now, atheists, they don't believe in religion. So they just attack the concept of sex in paradise because they don't believe in God. You know, they just think it's funny. So they just make fun of it. They don't really have a problem with it. Now, the people who do have a problem with sex in paradise are the Christians. They have a major problem with it. They have, I don't know, they have some moral objection to it. In fact, a Christian asked me to debate on this topic, and I said, what's there to debate? You know, I believe in sex in paradise. You don't. I'm not going to try to defend it. I'm going to say, hallelujah, bring it on. Sex in paradise, yes, please. Bring it on. Sex in paradise, yes, please. Bring it on. Sex in paradise, yes, please.
I told you guys so many times, maybe some of you are hitting this the first time. Wallahi. In Jannah, what do you want? You want girls? Jannah, there's girls. There's girls. What do you want? Drink, there's rivers of wine. You want yards, there's yards. Gold brick, silver brick, gold brick, silver brick. You can chew, you can party, you can rave. You can play up in Jannah. Jannah is so banging. Look what Allah said. When Allah described Jannah, look what He said. He described the drink in Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَيُسْقَوْنَ مِنْ رَحِيقٍ مَخْتُومٍ. They'll be made to drink from رَحِيقٍ مَخْتُومٍ, which is a drink. There's nothing purer in it and there's nothing more tastier in it. That drink is so banging. Allah said, وَفِي ذَلِكَ, for this drink, فَلْيَتَنَافَسِ الْمُتَنَافِسُونَ. For this drink, compete with each other. Jannah, forget Jannah. The drink is so bad. The drink is so nice. That the whole of this world, if you worshipped Allah and competed with each other in righteous actions, just to get a sip of that drink is worth it. Let alone everything else. You can have that.
What is authentic is that a martyr who dies on the battlefield in the cause of Allah Azza wa Jal, defending the religion of Islam, will be rewarded with 72 of these hur al-'ain.
Jannah has in it eternal spouses for every single person who enters it. Al-Hur al-Ain, eternal spouses. The Hur are those creations of Allah that words cannot describe their beauty. Words cannot do justice to how radiant and how glorious they are.
What an embarrassment. What an embarrassing prophet. What a disgusting religion.
So you think I'm old with my rep? Well, I'll tell you, girl, I'm the Miggity Mac. While you were in diapers and wetting the sheets, I'll be peeking in your window, whacking to the beat. Sure, I rustled some cattle and fondled some sheep, but my main concern was whacking to the beat. I don't bother nobody, I'm a real nice guy, but I like them real little, cause I like to hear them. I'm talking here and now, later for the cattle and fondling a cow. When I see a little baby and I need to skeet, you can bet your sweet tippy I'll be whacking to the beat.
No. So you think that having sex with a 9-year-old is justified?
Yeah. I mean, the thing is that so here, let me ask you a question. Okay. Is the problem with...
No, you a question.
I have to frame it. Okay. So if you have... Do you have a problem with child marriage because you think it is categorically wrong, or is it because it's conditionally wrong?
Well, I'm asking you the question.
I want to understand what your understanding is. Because I think that the Prophet, peace be upon him, his marriage to Aisha was at 9 years of age.
21.
So do you think that I don't think that that's wrong. I can explain it and justify it. And I'm trying to give you the entire anthropological explanation and the historical explanation of that. But like I said, it can't be done in 5 minutes.
I want
to simplify it and say, do you think that this is categorically wrong or is it conditionally wrong?
Categorically wrong.
Well,
I'm the Muslim cowboy playing my guitar. Girl, I hear you're 9 years old, so climb on in my car. If you try to run away, you won't get very far, cause I will beat you senseless while I scream Allah Akbar. Ho, ha, la, la, lee, 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 lee.
Right?
Well, I have a flag that you can replace your flag with. Take this Uyghur flag, you son of a... Takbir! I tell you today!
Woohoo! Yes! The only Saudi bikini model, you go girl!
You're a liar! I wanna trust you and I have to hate you as well!
So the point is you won't have a conversation with me because I'm a Christian.
No, I won't believe anything you say because you're a liar. And you're a Christian as well. So I hate you for the sake of Allah.
You hate me for the sake of Allah.
I hate you for the sake of Allah.
Alright.
I hate you for the sake of Allah. Every Christian, I hate you all for the sake of Allah. Any Jew, any Christian, I hate you all for the sake of Allah.
He hates me for the sake of Allah.
You hate these bastards and the other bastards.
Would you kill me if you get a chance?
If we're what, I would chop your head off.
Yeah, Allah guides you.
If we're fighting a war, am I supposed to let him kill me? I said, if we are.
No, let's ask this again. Do you hate me?
Yes, I hate you for the sake of Allah.
Who taught you to hate me?
And we're proud of that.
Alhamdulillah, we're proud of that.
And we're proud of
the
that.
The capital punishment. Alhamdulillah, we're proud of that.
What?
Alhamdulillah.
Would he kill me?
Alhamdulillah, I'm proud of it.
Would he kill me?
Alhamdulillah, I'm proud of it.
Would he kill me?
I'm proud of it.
I'm an ex-Muslim.
What are you gonna do, bruv? I'm proud
would
of it.
Would he kill me?
What are you gonna do?
I'm an ex-Muslim.
I'm proud of it. What are you gonna do?
But what do you want?
I'm proud of it. What are you gonna do?
I'm an ex-Muslim.
I'm proud of it.
Would he kill me?
What are you gonna do? I'm proud of it.
Would he kill me?
What are you gonna do, bruv?
Okay.
I'm proud of it.
Okay. Okay.
Alhamdulillah.
I'm an ex-Muslim.
Alhamdulillah.
Would he kill me?
Alhamdulillah. Why are you trying to Alhamdulillah.
What's wrong?
Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah, bruv. See, he has problem. He is threatening to kill me, bro.
Alhamdulillah, your problem. Your problem.
No.
Your problem.
I love you. I love you in Christ.
I don't love you, brother.
You don't love me.
I don't love you.
You don't love me.
I don't love you.
Okay, I forgive you. I pray for you, and I love you. This is what Islam teaches.
This is what Islam teaches. Listen, Alhamdulillah.
So, yes or no? Would he kill me if I'm an ex-Muslim?
There is a capital punishment in Islam.
Would he kill me? Yes or no?
Capital punishment. Let me tell you. In Islam, there's a capital punishment. If you live in the Sharia, I will have popcorn and I'll be watching it.
You'll kill me.
Listen, did I say I'll kill him? Thank you. Now, there is a capital punishment in Islam, and I'm telling you, I am proud of it, bruv.
You're proud of that?
I am proud of it, bruv.
So Jesus is saying to forgive your enemies, to love your enemies, to pray for your enemies, and you're telling them to kill them.
Alhamdulillah, bro.
Look at Jesus compared to Muhammad.
Now that you read that verse to me, guess what happened?
What's happened?
My point of view all goes to the bin. Do you understand that?
Then it goes one way, where?
The idea I had before of the verse is in the bin now.
Okay. And?
As a Muslim, listen, we don't use our brain. If Allah contradicts our brain, we take our brain out of the sight. We take our brain out of the world. You understand?
That's wonderful.
We use Allah and Him.
So what do you use? If you don't use your brain, what do you use? What do you use? If you don't use your brain, if you just told me, we Muslims, we don't use our brain. Okay?
Yes.
So what do you use?
If it contradicts to Allah.
Mm. So now your brain contradicts the stupidity of Allah, so you decide to throw your brain in the bin.
Listen, for example, when I was younger, I would not agree with what is it called, a father marrying the stepdaughter of his stepson. I mean, the wife of his stepson. You understand? But since the Quran allows it, that that logic goes to the bin.
Was Islam expanded by the sword? Why did our Prophet kill 750 people at the Banu Qurayza? Why did this man who's a role model marry 11 women? Why? And as I said, historically speaking, the vast majority of converts that converted across the globe, it was because of groupthink. Your people are converting, you're going to convert as well. Well, that's not going to happen by and large in this land unless Allah wills a miracle, but that is atypical. That has never happened in human history, as far as I know, where people just converted en masse by themselves. Always it was either the political dominion or their rulers, and essentially that's another type of political dominion, right? And by the way, this is why I never sugarcoat the political expansion of Islam. It's ludicrous to do so. Listen to my seerah. Listen to my, when I talked about Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhu and the wars of expansion. And I go into this detail. Was Islam expanded by the sword? And I'm very frank. This is not the time to go into there. But because of my experiences, I never sugarcoat.
One of the reasons I accepted Islam was the scientific miracles. I'll be honest with you. And now we know that this whole scientific miracles was absolute nonsense. Not in total, but guess what? Allah led me to Islam. One of the reasons was because of the scientific miracles. And guess what? Did I leave Islam when this whole scientific miracle thing got debunked? No.
When science comes and says, cousins must not get married to one another, we do not look at science and neglect our own religion. So we look in the Quran, it doesn't say anything about that. We look into the Sunnah, there's no prohibition, none whatsoever about that. On the contrary, we find that the Prophet himself, alayhi salatu wasalam, married his cousin, Zainab bin Jahsh, the mother of the believers, may Allah be pleased with her. If there was anything wrong, he would not have done that. Or Allah would have told us that this is not recommended. Not only that, he gave his own daughter Fatima to his own cousin Ali ibn Abi Talib. He also gave Zainab, his own daughter, the daughter of Muhammad, to her cousin Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi', and they were all their maternal cousins. So the whole of Islamic history has nothing against cousins marrying one another. So when science comes and says, oops, this is not recommended, this is not permissible or advisable, we, with all due respect, throw it in the dustbin.
In the Quran, in chapter 57, verse 25, the Quran says, and we sent down iron. Yes, this is relatively true that in some meteorites you have iron ore, right? So iron was sent down from that perspective. Does that mean it's a scientific miracle? No, because you had the ancient Egyptians 1400 years before the prophethood of the Prophet Muhammad upon him be peace. They described iron as ba-en-pet, which means iron from heaven.
Right.
This was like over 1,000 years before the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So you can't claim miraculousness here. But oh, another example. Sorry, there's more examples. The moon being a broad light. The Quran says in chapter 10, verse 5, it is he who made the sun a shining light and a moon a derived light. Nuran means derived light. Now let's ignore how the word shining light and nuran are interchangeable in the Quran. Let's ignore that for a minute. Let's just stick to the topic that some Muslims use this word nuran to show that the moon doesn't have its own light because it reflects the light of the sun. Because nuran means like a borrowed light. Yes, that's true. But 500 years BC, 1200 years before the prophethood, before the Quranic revelation, Thales said the moon is light from the sun. Another Greek, Anaxagoras, in around the same period, he asserted the moon doesn't have its own light, but light from the sun. What about, for example, the Big Bang? The Quran says in chapter 21, verse 30, have not those who disbelieve known that the heavens and the earth were one piece? Then we parted them. Yes, it's very ambiguous. We don't know the howness and the kind of intricate details. That's not the point of this verse. The point is for us to be in awe and for us to say that God deserves to be worshipped. But this doesn't really refer to the Big Bang, because what Big Bang? There are 20 different models, more than 20 models maybe. The quantum fluctuation model, oscillation model, the Friedman-Lemaitre model, all these models. What model are we choosing here? And these are not even hardcore facts in science anyway. And not even that, you have Sumerian literature in the Epic of Gilgamesh that reflects this kind of narrative. It says, when the heavens had been separated from the earth, when the earth had been delimited from the heavens, when the fame of mankind had been established. And the Quran says, when the heavens and the earth were one piece and we parted them. Similar kind of narrative. It's highly bizarre for us to make such a claim that he couldn't have access to this knowledge. That's not true. Especially when in Egypt, in around, I think, the 6th century, they already had, in Alexandria, I believe, translations of Greek medical documents. Yeah. I mean, it's not that far. They went to China, forget Egypt, yeah?
Yep.
So to make such a claim denies our own Islamic history.
In the Andrew Tate video that I did, I mentioned that the scientific miracles in the Quran got debunked. And for some odd reason, funnily enough, like as if they thought that it was a slip of the tongue, I'll repeat it again, very carefully.
the scientific miracles argument in the Quran got debunked.
Muslims believe. This is their conviction. You like it, you don't like it, you're disgusted by it. Who cares? I believe in whatever the Prophet said, as long as the hadith is authentic.
Before the revelation came to me, I began to hear the rocks and stones greet me in my path. This is he himself telling the Sahaba. That before the revelation began, I would hear the rocks and stones saying salam to me. And I would look around and not find anybody until I realized it's a rock and stone. And then he said, this hadith is in Muslim, that, and there was a particular rock that always gave salam to me. And I recognize it to this day in Mecca. I know exactly which rock that was.
There are idiots.
No.
Within the Muslim community, absolutely, many of them.